everyone. Welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever wanted to work less and do more of what you want to do, then do we have the Will It Fly show for you. Today, I'll be talking with Pat Flynn, best-selling author, passive income expert, and the author of two phenomenal books on building freedom, Let Go and Will It Fly. And that's just what I want to talk with him about today, about finding your runway and taking off. That plus we'll talk about the importance of Back to the Future, Sean Noonan, eating at Momo's, visits to Panera's, AdSense and $1.08, why you might look like an injured gazelle on the Serengeti, and whether poorly installed water heaters will really blow through the roof. So welcome to the show, Pat. Are you ready to shine?
Oh, I'm shining already, shining bright, and very happy to be here. Thank you so much, Michael.
Well, thank you so much, and a mighty woohoo for being on the show.
Let's do it.
So before we dive right into things, how's your son, Keone, doing at making paper airplanes and other things these days?
Oh, he's kind of moved on from paper airplanes now. He's moving on to, actually, we just built this really cool space in our garage we call the Makery. Mm-hmm. It's based off of a room that they have at his school where literally you just go in there and build whatever craft you feel like building. And so we put one of those in our garage, and he's building all kinds of things now, mostly, you know, various types of kid friendly type weapon type things like boys would normally do. But, you know, I'm in there and I'm helping him out, and, you know, he's putting a lot of cool things together and using his brain, and just, it's so awesome to see him flourish and not be afraid to fail. I think that's my favorite part about it. And once he gets to a point where something's not working the way he wants, instead of just giving up like he used to, he now tries to figure out a way to solve that problem.
Now he's what, 6, 7 now, maybe 7?
He's 7, yes.
And what has been, and you talk about it a bit in your second book, what has been the secret to helping him understand he can't fail?
Well, to be honest, it's leading by example. I think that's a big thing, to show him that I also fail and that it's okay. And I think kids are sponges. I mean, we all know that. And so, they often follow the footsteps of their parents. And so the more that you can share how you have failed, it just makes you seem more real and mm-hmm. vulnerable, which allows them to grow stronger and appreciate you more. But also walk them through the process of how you might be solving a problem that's bothering you. I do that all the time with things related to my business as well. I get Keone in my office and I talk about some of the things I'm working on. Most of the stuff that I bring him in for are things like editing videos or messing with the podcast and fun little things that I know he'd be interested in. But he's seeing little examples of how I'm failing and how I'm figuring it out. And I'm noticing now that he's sort of following the same pattern.
Awesome. And it sounds like you're treating him like a little man, like another equal, just with a different skill set right now.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and we all, no matter what age we're at, have the ability to learn. So no matter what age he is, I'm sure I'm going to always be there to hopefully lead by example.
Awesome. And for your older daughter, well, your only daughter, but older as well, Kialani, you're still going to her dance classes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. She's doing hula and she's dancing at home all the time. That's her sort of passion right now. And so we're helping her flourish with that as much as possible, too. And, you know, we've done some other things related to music to help her explore. I mean, that's what this is all about. It's never about forcing them to do one thing or another, but just showing that they have different options available to them. So, you know, we purchased a piano and I mess around on that and I tickle the ivories every once in a while. And, you know, Kai starts to dance, but she's also playing with it a little bit, too. And if she seems to take interest in it, we may end up getting her lessons at some point to kind of take that skill even further.
Awesome. So I want to go back in time a little bit. Maybe we'll actually go way on back. And I had an experience with this too. I'm sure different than yours. But did you have two ADD parents?
No, I did not. My dad was very much an older traditional. He was actually a little bit older for a father than some of my other friends. But he worked 9 to 5. Mm-hmm. He did the same thing every single day, it seemed, and would come home at the same time every day and would read the paper at the same time every day. And every day was exactly the same. I got a lot of inspiration from him in terms of how he was able to support the family. And that's why I wanted a career as stable as his. I actually went to school for architecture and I had envisioned sort of the same process of coming home to my family every day after a long, hard day of work, but doing stuff that I loved. And I know that he loved what he did too, although he couldn't talk about it with me because it was government work and it was classified. So that's that. My mom, I got inspiration from her from how hardworking she is. And she would often take jobs that were unnecessary to take for money purposes, but necessary for her to take as far as wanting to serve people. And she literally served people with her work. So for when I went into elementary school, she came to the school as a lunch lady. So she was a lunch lady. And then when
Wow, go mom.
Went, Yeah, and when she went to Wagenheim, which was my middle school, she followed me there and was a lunch lady there too. And it was pretty interesting because when it was high school time, I was like, Mom, can you just stay in middle school? Like, don't follow me to high school, please. But she just loved to serve people, loved to be there every day, loved to build relationships with the kids in the school, even people I didn't even know loved her to death because she was always friendly and stuff like that. So I learned serving from her, and her second job, which again, she didn't even need, was as a security guard because she wanted to help people in any which way she could. And she's a very strong woman. She was actually a black belt in karate. She could break five bricks with her head and all these other crazy things that kind of scared my dad and me and other people.
I love it. Okay, so let's fast forward from there. You get a BA in architecture in Berkeley. Mm-hmm. And then there was the restaurant visit heard around the world at Momo's.
Yes, Momo's is a restaurant across from Pac Bell Park, or AT&T Park now, I think it is called, in San Francisco, where the Giants play. And this restaurant was owned by a person who was in the California marching band, which I was in at the time. That's why I got invited, because I had become student director of the band. And myself and the drum major and the secretary and a couple other people got invited, about six of us, to have dinner that evening with this guy named Peter, who owned the restaurant. And he was a tuba player back in the day who had gotten really successful. And every year he would take the new executive committee because he wanted to meet them. And it was just literally just us in the restaurant, which was really cool. So he sat down and we had conversations about what we did. And it came around to my turn and he asked, well, what I majored in? I said, architecture. He said, oh, what kind of architecture do you like? And I said, well, I like restaurant architecture and hospitality, like stuff like this is a beautiful restaurant. And he's like, you know what, Pat? I know a guy. His name is John McNulty. He's the principal of MBH Architects, which is just right around the corner in Alameda. I'm going to introduce him to you and see if he can get you a job. And I was like, oh my gosh, really? You know, I was like, that's cool. But I never really thought that was like a serious thing, because that was an incredible offer. But, you know, to get a job for architecture from a marching band sort of connection versus, you know, the traditional sending out resumes and putting it out there, which I was going to do just a few months later after graduating. I got a call the next day from John McNulty, and he asked me to come in an interview to see if it would be a right fit for me to come in and work in the restaurant division in that architecture firm. And they liked me, apparently. And when summer came around, I started working there, and it was great. And I worked there for a number of years until the famous year of 2008, when a lot of people lost their jobs. And I was one of those people, which at the time was one of the worst things to ever happen to me, it felt. But looking back, it was actually one of the greatest things to ever happen.
If we were to back up just a little bit, first, actually, going back to the restaurant, were restaurants really your thing? Was this some amazing synchronicity? How did that come together, do you think?
You know, I was just – because when I was – at that point, I was curious in terms of, okay, well, there's different kinds of architecture firms that I could get involved with. You know, mm-hmm. I'm looking for a job. What options do I have? And so I just started looking around, and residential wasn't anything I really wanted to do, and I didn't want to do any sort of big box retailing type stuff, cookie cutter type stuff. But restaurants were really interesting to me, and I always had enjoyed eating and kind of was fascinated by sort of places where you eat. And also I had worked as a waiter for a little bit, so I think I just was very familiar with spaces where people eat and where people cook and how that might potentially function even better. And that's kind of where that all came from.
Awesome. So you're working at this company, and well, until 2008 anyway, and in there you're working 70, 80 hours a week drafting.
Yes.
And you're trying to figure out, this is where the coolness starts to happen with Pat. You're trying to figure out, because it's supposed to be what, 3, 4, maybe 5 years to become job captain, how you can shortcut the whole thing.
Right, exactly. So one thing that I wanted to do was take charge and just do as much work as I could so that I can impress my bosses, so I could fast track to the point at which I would then become an architect. My goal was to be one of the youngest architects to have been licensed in the Bay Area. I just had set that goal for myself, and I knew it was going to take a number of years to get there. But the first step was to see if I could, you know, between drafter and principal or at least licensed architect, get to the next level and quickly. And the next level was job captain. Actually, the first level was entry level drafter. Then it was senior drafter. So I got promoted to that after a short period of time. And then it was job captain. Mm-hmm. And so I did a lot of things that I didn't even have to do. For example, I went to AIA meetings or the American Institute of Architects meetings and just learned from there. I went to conventions and other things that I didn't even need to go to, but I would come back with all this great information that I could share with my project manager. I would take tests that I didn't even need to take, but one of those tests was called the LEED exam. And actually, the interesting thing about that was after getting a 4.2 in high school and graduating magna cum laude, I took this test and I was like so confident. And I took a practice test just to kind of see what it was like and just to see how quickly I could get past it. Well, I ended up getting a 25% on that exam.
Wow.
Which if you are somebody who is used to getting A's all your life, that it was pretty detrimental to me to see, wow, this is okay. I don't know anything about this. I actually put that exam aside for a little bit to take a few other things and do other responsibilities that I could choose to do. But then I came back to it because this was an industry. The LEED exam was called Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, and that was related to green buildings and environmental safe environmental designing. And so I really tried to tackle that in the best way that I could, and that was to study every day, to write down my notes, and actually to help me study. One of the things I figured out was that I could actually build a website to keep track of my notes, because a lot of what I needed to learn and the reason why I failed so miserably the first time was because not only was I supposed to memorize this reference guide that was about 400 pages in length, mm-hmm. but in addition to that, each section had a number of links that I was supposed to go and read more about so that I can learn. And so I decided to kind of put all that information online, the things about each section plus the links, so that it was just very easy for me to access versus carrying around this big giant guide and having to go online every time after that. So I created that website and I studied off of it, and that was up for about a year almost until I finally took the exam in March of 2008.
Yep.
And I passed, and I barely passed, but I passed, and I was happy. And then a couple of my coworkers ended up using the website to help them as well. I had no intention of ever doing anything else with the website. I literally just let it sit there. Things were going so well because of that exam that I passed. I became a job captain, the youngest in the firm to do so. So I had achieved that goal. Things were going so well. I was making more money than I had ever expected to make at that age. I ended up proposing to my girlfriend, and she said
Woo-hoo!
Yes. And so life was great. You know, March of 08, things were fantastic. I was on top of the world. I was contributing to my 401k. I had a health plan. Like, everything was exactly the way it was supposed to be. And I was looking forward to then getting ready to start studying for the architectural exam. But then June 2008 rolls around, and the recession, and I get called into my boss's office. And he goes, Pat, like, dude, you're one of the youngest, brightest guys we know. We've never had anybody ever become job captain at such a young age, and we know you have a ton of potential, but unfortunately, we have to let you go. And I was like, I don't know if you've ever gotten punched in the stomach and kind of lost your wind, but it was like that, but times 1,000. And I just my initial reaction was anger, and I got upset. I got upset at my boss. I was like, how could you do this to me? But, you know, it wasn't his fault. It was just nobody. They had held me on to me as long as possible at that point, it seemed. Then I got sad and worried, like, would I let my parents down? What's my wife, my fiance April going to say? Like, is she still going to be with me? And like all these things racing through my head. And of course, being a guy, I'm like, okay, hold up, put the brakes on. Let's fix this. Like, that's like the first intuition for a guy. Like, okay, let's fix this.
Mm-hmm.
So I go on the phone like right after I was told, and I call every single architecture firm I'd ever had contact with, every single person who I'd went to school with, every single contractor, every single engineering firm that we'd ever worked with, and just begged for a job. And it got so low to a point where I was just like, I will do secretary work. I will be front desk. Like, I couldn't imagine life without architecture in my life. Mm-hmm. That's what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. That's where the starting point happened in terms of discovering all these other things that were available to me. I don't know where you want to go from there, but
we're going to go into the trenches. We're going to rebuild you from there. But I'm curious, because you have a pattern here, which is fairly unique. Where the fire in your belly come from? Most people, although they're going to go doo, 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 and do some sort of charge, they're not going to be quite as committed or thorough as you. In studying for the leads, they're not going to go for it quite the same way you did. And they're not going to think, how can I circumvent this whole process to jump ahead and skip all the rungs in the ladder? So I'm wondering where that fire in the belly came from.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, I've always been somebody who has tried to figure things out and be efficient with it, mm-hmm. and do better. I don't know if this, I mean, you can go back to your marching band. You know, perhaps part of the reason why I wanted to play the trumpet was because it was the loudest thing in the room, right? And I don't know if you know anything about people in the marching band or people who play instruments, but trumpets are usually the kinds of people who are like, hey, I can do it better than you kind of thing. Like there's a joke, how many trumpet players does it take to screw in a light bulb? It's three. One to screw in the light bulb and two to tell that person how much better they could do it. And so I don't know if that's just part of my personality to not try and be better than anybody else, but better than my previous self always, and always trying to figure out the most efficient ways to do things. And it's just always been a part of me.
What was your mindset? Thank you for sharing on that. What was your mindset? If I understand, you had to move back, or it was a choice to move back with your family, and that started this rebuilding process. In a sense, I don't know if you think about it that way, but you got put into the cocoon.
Yeah, I did, which enabled me to sort of refigure things out. I feel very blessed for getting let go because it allowed me to almost step back a little bit and reconsider what all my options were. Going back to my parents' home, it wasn't as detrimental as it may sound. My parents were amazing, and I was just so thankful that I was there. It did make me feel like the worst thing that could ever happen wasn't that bad, mm-hmm. in case I wasn't able to get back into architecture or something else happened. My wife also moved back in with her parents too. We had to save for a wedding. That was essentially the main reason why we did that. And I don't know if you know this, but the Filipino culture, like when you have a wedding, because my wife's Filipino, I'm half Filipino myself. When you have a wedding, you're supposed to invite everybody that you know, like your mom and your parents, obviously. Her friends, but then her friends' friends too. And it's like, you know that you're going to have this giant wedding. So we were doing everything we could in our power to save as much money as possible. And so I moved back home, and that's where I started to just really not necessarily get into a terrible state of depression, but just kind of it made me reanalyze, okay, well, what am I doing? Where am I supposed to go? Now, I didn't get let go immediately from my position. I had a couple months to think of things because they couldn't just let me go. I was a job captain. I had people who I was responsible for. I also had clients who I was the liaison for. So they couldn't just let me go that day. But I had a termination date in October of 2008. And so I had a few months to kind of figure things out. But I ended up taking the train every day from San Diego to Irvine, which is just kind of mid-California a little bit, a couple hours every single day. Yeah. It's cheaper than driving. I needed to make any sort of income I did, so I didn't just leave right away and Pulaski were going to give me a nice severance package for the work that I had done. So I had a little bit of a cushion. But on that train ride, I remember feeling really jealous of everybody who was on that train. Every time somebody came in, I would often ask myself, man, why can't I be like that guy? Like that guy has a job. He has his coat. He has his laptop with him, and he has no worries in the world. Like I don't even know this person, but I'm already judging them based on where I'm at in my life. And I just got really sad all the time. But then I remember I had just gotten tired of listening to my playlist of sad music, right, to go up and down the coast. That's when I went into iTunes and I saw this section that I had never seen before called podcasts. And I was like, whoa, this is interesting. There's all this free audio here. Like, this is incredible. I don't even have to purchase anything. Great, because I need to save money anyway. So let me just explore. And so I ended up diving into the business section for some reason. I don't even know what drove me there. But then I found a podcast called Internet Business Mastery, hosted by Jeremy Franson and Jason Van Orden. And I started listening to that show, and I immediately started to connect with them and their message. And it was much different than all the other messages that I had ever read about doing online business, which were very much coming from a place of too salesy, or they're selling snake oil, or just get rich quick. Like, I was not about that. I knew that wasn't possible. I didn't want to get scammed into anything like that. But when I heard Jeremy and Jason, they really made it feel like this was something that a person could do if they really put their mind to it. And they had interviewed a number of people on the show who were sharing their success stories about how they built their online businesses. And what was really cool was listening to the diversity of different kinds of businesses that people built. But there was one episode in particular by a guy named Cornelius who was helping he was making six figures a year by helping people pass the project management exam, or the PM exam. And that was I remember that train ride, because that's when, what? Like, I have exam experience for a lot of different things. Like, maybe I could do what this guy is doing, but just in this lead exam space or other exam. And then I just started to get really juiced up and fired up about it. And I remember continually listening to their content and not going on the train anymore being sad, but going on the train as sort of that was my vehicle for hope. And that's what enabled me to start to begin to consume a lot of this online business content, to get inspired by these guys. They came out with a course. I ended up spending and investing I think, a couple hundred dollars into that because I knew it would be worth it, and it definitely was. And not only did I get content that helped me figure out, okay, how to build a website, how to create these things. Now, I had already built a website, like I said, but I kind of could fine-tune what I had already built and then actually start keeping track of things, which was really cool. But not only that, there was a community of other people who were at the same level as me, who were just as inspired as me, who I connected with, and we all helped each other, and we found out about where we lived, and we became friends, and we held each other accountable, which was really cool. But probably one of the coolest first moments I had online was when I put a tracking tool on that website that I helped to build to pass that exam. Again, I had left that website just sitting there for a while, and I had no idea what was going on there because I didn't have any tools. Like, why would I need any tools to track traffic? It was just built for me. But I remember the moment I put that traffic tool on, I think it was just simply Google Analytics because I finally learned how to do that. The next day I saw a few thousand hits to my website, and I was like, wait a sec, like this can't be right. Like, how could, I don't even know how people found out about it. I never shared it with anybody. Maybe it's counting just the number of times I visited the website, but I don't remember visiting it 1,000 times yesterday. But then the next day, a few more thousand, and then Google starts to tell you sort of where your traffic is coming from. And I saw like 80% of my traffic was coming from Google. So Google had apparently ranked my website for a number of keywords related to this industry, and people were looking for information, and my website was popping up, and people were on the site apparently getting information, and I had no idea because I didn't enable comments, because why would I need to enable comments if I didn't plan to share it with anybody? So I enabled the comments, and then immediately I started getting people asking me all these questions. What's exam day like? What was it like for you? Tell me more about this. And I actually knew some of the answers to those questions. I didn't know all of them, but I had access to the answers to all of them. And so I started to reply, and sort of slowly but respectively, quite quickly, become this expert in this space, this personality who was sharing this information. And then I remember right around the same time, Jeremy, who is one of the hosts of that podcast, he moved to San Diego, which is where I was staying with my parents. And he said, hey, if anybody's in San Diego, I'd love to meet you. Like, we're going to meet at this Panera Bread in Mira Mesa. My parents' home was in Mira Mesa. I was like, oh my gosh. Like, right? I was like, oh man, I have to go. I have to go to this, even though I didn't want to because I was deathly afraid and I didn't think I had anything to contribute. But I remember going to Panera Bread, and I was sort of the last one to arrive. There were like six or seven guys there who were all around this table outside drinking coffee. And then I go and I sit down and I introduce myself. And I obviously knew Jeremy from his voice and the way he looked. And then I got to be introduced to everybody else. And I just sat there totally quiet, listening to every single person just talk. And they were saying things I didn't understand. And just I was like, oh, gosh, I am with the wrong group. I have no idea what's going on. I have nothing to contribute. I should probably just go. I feel completely uncomfortable right now. But then it got around to my turn, and everybody's like, hey, Pat, like, tell us what you're doing online. Like, why did you join Internet Business Mastery? What project you got going on? So I told them about my layoff. I told them about this website that I had, and they were like, oh, cool. That website sounds really interesting. And they actually re-mentioned Cornelius. They were like, oh, that's just like that guy Cornelius who was helping people pass the project management exam. I was like, yes, that's exactly where I got this inspiration to do this from. So that was kind of cool. And they were like, okay, so like this website, how long has it been up? Like, how much traffic do you have? And I was like, well, it's been up for like over a year because I had it, and now I'm actually doing something with it. I mean, there's, I only get like a few thousand visits. And they're like, oh, that's pretty good. Like, few thousand visits per month. Like, that's really good. You can do something with that. And I was like, no, that's like a few thousand visits per day. And they were like, the brakes went on, and they all focused their attention on me. And I was like, whoa, they were all helping me figure things out. They were like, first of all, they couldn't believe that I had that much traffic already, but it wasn't already. It wasn't like it just put it up overnight. It had been sitting in Google for a while, like gaining this authority. But then they were like, here's what you can do next. And I was just jotting down as many notes as I could. And basically what came out of it was I should publish a study guide for my audience there and actually like charge for it, which scared the crap out of me. I was like, what? Like, are you allowed to do that? Like, am I even qualified to do this? Like these initial, like that's how it is. Like you come up with these ideas, and then immediately your brain starts going why you shouldn't do it, right? And that's the moment I was in. But I started to get all this encouragement, and I got this first steps that I should take from them. And so my first thought was, okay, I just need to write this thing. I'm not even going to worry about how to sell it. I know the number one thing I need to do is just write this thing, and then I can figure it out after. So I spent a good month and a half like writing this thing, sharing it with the people inside as I was creating it, and they were giving me tips here and there. Then eventually I had about an 83-page document that really walks people through beginning to end how to pass this exam. And I knew it was great. And I remember getting advice from the guys in terms of how to sell it online. I was using a tool called the eJunkie to put that file into eJunkie. And then eJunkie gives you a link that you put on your website. And I remember at 2 in the morning, this was just a couple weeks or week or so before I was going to be let go permanently. And I was like, okay, this has to work, right? This is my ticket. And so I put it on the website. I didn't even know how. I just put a link at the bottom of the homepage and a link in the sidebar. That's it. I didn't know anything about funnels or all this other advanced stuff. And that was 2 in the morning because I had spent all night putting that together. And then I had to go to bed and wake up in 4 hours to take the train. So I go to bed. I wake up 4 hours later. I check my – like the first thing I do even before going to the bathroom is I check my sales. No sales. I'm like, oh, man. Like this is – what am I thinking? This I'd woken up at 6 in the morning expecting that within the 4 hours in the early morning days that there would be sales. And so I was like, okay, maybe I'm just a little too ambitious here. Yeah. I'm going to go to work and maybe I'll check there because it was early in the morning anyway. So I go to work, arrive around 8:30. Again, check my email the first thing. I'm like hardly working at all anymore at this point. It's like major senioritis. And then I check the sales and there are no sales. And I said, okay, well, I gave it a shot. That's it. 10 minutes later, it was like, I think it was like 8:40 or 8:41, I got a notification from PayPal saying that there was an email and they had deposited $19.95 into my account minus a few PayPal fees. And it was my first sale ever. And it was the most incredible, overwhelming, scariest feeling in the world. Because like I said earlier, the first thought that came to mind after that initial like, oh my gosh, this is working was, oh my gosh, what if they ask for a refund? What if they sue me? What if something happens as a result of getting into – like I had no idea what was going on. I literally had to go outside and walk – take a walk to breathe it off. I was almost hyperventilating. And when I came back to my desk, another sale had been made while I was up and walking around.
Awesome.
And that's when I knew. I was like, whoa. Like this is the start of something pretty cool. And you know, a week and a half later, I was let go. But the business started to make more sales. And that month, the same month as my termination date, I had made $7,905.88 or something like that. And it just – that was more money than I had ever made as a job captain. And I just couldn't believe it. And I still pinched myself every single day. And then things just started kept growing from there. I added more products like an audiobook to go on top of it. And by the time March 2009 rolled around, I was making between $20,000 and $30,000 a month from what later became a $29.99 ebook. I had raised the price and it was just blowing my mind. Absolutely.
So thank you for sharing on that. How much have you're in Forbes magazine, I believe it was, in the top 10 business leaders for transparency. How much have you made since then?
About over $4 million in online earnings.
And so you
it's crazy.
And you're on a mission to help others to make income in the same way as well.
Right. Well, the interesting thing was after I had proven myself a little bit in terms of surviving the recession and people started to see that I was, you know, doing well, I started to get a lot of people asking me how I did that. I mean, even that in that first month, people were like, Pat, you need to share this. Like, I didn't know about this. You didn't know about this until finally somebody told you, like, you need to pay it forward and share all as much as you can. So that's why in the same month, October of 2008, right around the end of it, I had registered the domain name for smartpassiveincome.com because I really wanted to share everything that I had learned. I had also gotten inspiration from Tim Ferriss and the 4-Hour Workweek, which came out just not too long before that. I mean, he talked a lot about this idea of not trading your time for money, but setting things up ahead of time to be able to pay you back more so afterwards. And that's exactly what I had done, which is why the term passive income was there. But the term smart was put in front of it because I wanted people to approach it in a smart way, not just diving in without knowing anything. But I wanted to be the one to share information that would help people even before they get started. And so that's where smart passive income came from. And I said, you know what? I'm just going to share it all. So even in that first month, I shared exactly how much money I made, how many sales I made, how I did it, what I wish I had done differently, what I was scared of. The whole thing. And I've since continued to still do that and be honest and upfront, which is why I think people have taken notice and for example, why I'm featured in Forbes and other places related to transparency and authenticity.
Awesome, and an incredible inspiration as well. I want to dive a little bit into your second book here in a minute. Before I do that, sure. I want to talk about what your number one driver or priority is in life, because that's one of the things about you from the first episode that I heard on Smart Passive Income that has really drawn me to you the most is your family first.
Always. Yeah, family is really important to me. It was something that, you know, even though my parents both worked quite often and I didn't see them as much as I wish I had, I mean, perhaps that's part of the reason why I wanted to live a flexible lifestyle where I could have systems in place work for me instead of the other way around and I can spend more time with my family. But my wife, I mean, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for her. She was there on day one, the moment I had gotten let go, who really gave me some amazing support, who believed in me, who told me literally, we're going to be okay no matter what happens, we're going to be okay. And then, of course, when the kids came around, it became even more inspirational for me to want to do things, and not just do things to make money and survive, but do things to be a good example. Like I said earlier, leading by example is my number one thing for my audience, for my kids, whatever. And that's you know, the best way to lead. There are my favorite leaders and people who I have learned a lot from in teachers mm-hmm. or professors. They're the ones who are showing me how to do it, not just telling me how to do it. And that's become something that's been a part of my life. And when it comes to my family, I mean, they are a huge motivator for me. And I know there's a lot of other families out there who wish they could spend more time with each other. And so I want to be able to enable families to do the same thing too, which is why there's this driving force behind smartpassiveincome.com.
You've inspired me because we're looking at kids in the next year or so ourselves, and yes. I'm going, what can I do to change what I'm doing now to ensure that I'm going to be able to spend the time for the first everything that you got to experience mm-hmm. with your children's lives?
Yeah, the first, you know, from the moment they were born, I've been there for all of their firsts. And I'm truly blessed to have been able to be able to say that. Both my wife and I bring and take home our kids from school mm-hmm. at the same time. And we're the only or one of the only sort of husband-wife combo that do that every single time. And the teachers noticed and the other parents noticed. And they always ask, what do you guys do? Did you like win the lottery or something and you just don't work anymore? And I'm like, no, I work and I work hard. But I work hard when I want to work and I'm with my family when I want to be with my family. And that's it.
Woo! So why is Back to the Future one of your all-time favorite movies?
You know, it's something I've watched early on when I was a kid, and I've just always been so fascinated with time travel and of course, the DeLorean and all those things. It's just a great story. But more than that, you know, I think we all have this idea that we wish we could always go back in time and change things, right? That's what happens in the movie. To be able to just hop into some vehicle and go back in time and you know, make different decisions. Because obviously we go through life and we don't always make the best decisions, or we don't go down the path that we had thought we were going to go down. And there are moments in our lives where we wish we could just have thought differently. And I think that's the case for everybody. And what Back to the Future does is it allows you to sort of imagine what that would be like. But of course, you can't go back into the past and change the past. But it also reflects on the fact that what you do now changes the future. And that's why I love it so much, because it really shows the impact of decisions that you make now and how they impact the future. It always forces me to really consider what will happen as a result of this decision that I'm making. And that's why the kids are also very much a motivation for me. I always envision them in the future mm-hmm. having lunch together, talking about mom and dad, right? And, you know, I think that's something we all do, especially siblings. I don't have siblings of my own, but even with friends and family and my wife, we talk about what our parents were like when we were growing up, right? And so I envision whenever I have a really important decision to make, my kids at a cafe talking about how I behaved at that moment. Did I make the right decision? And that drives me in the right direction most of the time in terms of thinking about how they would actually respond to these things that I do, because they are a main reason why I'm living and why I'm here. And I want to make sure I continue to lead by example. But that's why I like Back to the Future. And plus, it's just the amazing story and the back, you know, just it's just so well put together. It's just a great story. And plus, a lot of the things that I know about the show, the movie, in terms of it's almost not even happening at all, to the rejections from studios. You know, it's very inspirational on so many different levels.
It's there's an interesting synchronicity. I was just thinking about, I was out running in a place called Jockey Hollow, kind of the story of the Headless Horseman, outside Morristown, New Jersey earlier this year. And I came across one of the set vehicles, or supposedly, Back to the Future DeLorean that had been driving through the park. And I'm like, what in the world is a DeLorean doing in the middle of my forest?
That's awesome.
So it was really cool. So if you don't mind me asking, where does faith fit into this picture? Because it sounds like you have a very strong faith.
Yeah, absolutely. I was raised Catholic. That was always a very important part of my life, and it still is. It's not something that I typically share online because I just don't want to start those conversations, because that can create divisions. And with my audience, I want unification, not division. So awesome. I hardly ever talk about that thing. But it is something that's really important to me. God has guided me in many ways in my life, and he continues to do so. And it's just something that, again, like I said, I don't normally talk about online. But it is important to me because it allows me to really believe in not just myself, but a higher being that's going to be there for me no matter what decisions I make. But I also feel like he's helping me in terms of guiding me in the right direction for a much bigger cause. I mean, that's where a lot of the ideas for philanthropy and going into other countries and building schools, and now even more so about education locally, how to help in that front. It's just pulling all those things in my life are kind of coming together to help for a much bigger cause now.
Awesome. And that's right. I had heard before about you taking off time to go build schools. What are you doing there?
Yeah. So I'm currently an advisor for an organization called Pencils of Promise. I have a giant pencil here. Mm-hmm. But this was started by a man named Adam Braun, who mm-hmm. had been inspired by going to a trip to India and asking kids, like, hey, if there's one thing in this world you want, what would you want right now? And one kid came up to me and he said, I wish I had a pencil. Because he just didn't have education. And that surprised him. And so Adam Braun had created this organization and started building schools in various countries around the world. And it makes it really easy for people to now create campaigns to be able to do the same. I did a birthday campaign at the end of 2014 where, instead of birthday presents or happy birthday wishes, I wanted people to, if they wanted to, contribute to the cause and to build a school for $25,000, which is what it had cost at the time. And I said, if we can do this as a community, mm-hmm. I will match that. So we will build two schools together. And they raised $28,000, my community did. So I matched that. And we built two schools in Ghana, Africa. And then I got to visit the schools as they were being built, or actually right after they had been built. And I went to the ribbon cutting ceremony for one of them, where the entire community of people in this little village had come together and just celebrated education, because they just didn't have access to good facilities for education or even have teachers at the time. So to see the impact that that's making and as a result of not just the money I've donated, but also the community that I've built and the fans, it's just amazing to see that impact kind of being put into places that really need it and that don't have those opportunities.
Dumbfounding, and that is a mighty woo-hoo!
So, absolutely.
On that note, you talked about getting guidance. I'm wondering, do you meditate? Do you sit? Do you go into the silence? How do you get the space to hear?
Yeah, I mean, there's a very specific morning routine that I go through. It's very much inspired by Hal Elrod and mm-hmm. the Miracle Morning. And that involves a number of things, including reading, visualizations, but definitely meditation. And meditation is something that for the longest time I thought was just the weirdest thing in the world. And I thought you had to sit cross-legged like this and hum for like 10 minutes and that's it. But I started to hear on a number of other podcasts that it was something that very successful entrepreneurs participated in. And I was like, well, this can't just be a woo-woo weird thing if all of these successful entrepreneurs are saying that this is actually really helpful for them. Like, let me turn that part, that bias off, and actually take the approach of, okay, let's try it before I knock it kind of thing. And so I started to experiment with it. I got involved with an app called Headspace, which was fantastic. And it really took me through the process, and I loved the voice, and I loved just how relaxed I felt. But I didn't know if it was working. I thought that maybe I just felt relaxed because I had my eyes closed and I had just kind of taken a rest from what I was doing. I wasn't sure if it was working. So where I went from there was, actually, I got some advice from a friend who had introduced me to this device called the Muse, M-U-S-E, mm-hmm. which is a little electronic device that you put on your head. It has sensors that can read your brain waves, and it can determine how active or not active your brain is. And so it works in conjunction with an application that you have, and it's almost like a game. So you put on the meditation app for 5 to 7 to 12 or 20 minutes, and during that time while you're meditating, it will give you feedback directly in your earbuds based on sounds that you hear. So you might pick the ocean scene, for example, to meditate in, and you close your eyes and you're just focusing on your breathing. And if your mind starts racing, like it often does, you will start to hear loud crashing waves and wind, and it'll be very noisy. But then you calm down and you start focusing on your breaths again, and then you start to hear hardly anything. And then sometimes you can win or earn birds chirping if you stay calm for a certain period of time. So what I love about this is it gamifies meditation for me. Mm-hmm. So I can always look to see how I can improve and get better. But more than that, it gives me immediate feedback as to whether or not I'm doing it right, which is something that I always seek. So whenever I go into any process at all, not just meditation, but anything, I'm always looking for feedback. Which is why I never do things alone now. Whenever I'm learning something new, I either find a coach or find a resource or purchase a course that can help me make sure I'm on the right track. And if I'm not, I go, and I'm not afraid to ask if I am or not and where I can get help to get back on track. That's one of the number one things that I can share with everybody listening to this right now. Yes, you can figure a lot of these things out on your own, but it's so much easier and faster and better quality information when you get it from somebody who's already done it prior to you. And there are so many people out there in this world who are willing to help, whether you have to pay them or not. That's not the issue. The issue is you having the sense to go out and actually seek those answers and find them. You find them quicker, you get them the right way, and then you can move on and progress from there.
And that makes sense. It also keeps you from going down the wrong direction for years, working as hard as you possibly can, getting farther from where you actually want to be.
Exactly.
So let's talk from there briefly. And your second book is absolutely amazing. I recommend everybody to go out and get it because it's really a how-to guide building your business and building your life. Maybe you can tell us what the four quadrant exercise is.
Yeah, so this is part of what I call the airport test. This was actually inspired by Gary Keller in his book, The One Thing. I actually spoke to his co-author, Jay Papasan, and he told me this process that they use to hire people into Keller Williams Realty, which is one of the biggest real estate sort of firms in the world. They use this process, this exercise, to vet whether or not the person who they are interviewing is right for the company, mm-hmm. and vice versa, right? How often do you hear employers making sure that they are right for the person they are interviewing? Usually we try to figure out, okay, is this the right person to fit into our business? No. It's a way to determine if there's a good fit there. And the way that that's done is, and I'll share this with you and everybody now, you could actually literally do this exercise right now. You take a piece of paper and you fold it into four quadrants. So fold it in half this way and then fold it in half the other way. And then you'll have four spaces. In each of the four spaces, title them at the top with the four most important areas of your life that are just meaningful to you. So it could be family, finances, health, business, if you're into athletics, maybe it's athletics or music, whatever, the top four categories that you feel define your life the most, put those in there. And then you bullet point underneath each of those, what would make you feel like you would say that life is awesome 5 years from now? So the reason it's called the airport test is to set this up. If you are at the airport 5 years from now, and you're just sitting there waiting at the terminal, and you're one of your friends from a long time ago comes up and taps you on the shoulder and is like, oh my gosh, Michael, I haven't seen you in so long. Like, do you have some time? Let's go get a coffee. And you say, yeah, let's go get a coffee. And you start talking and this person goes, Michael, like, tell me about life. Like, what's going on? And you say, life couldn't get any better. It is awesome right now. The trick is, what would make you say that 5 years from now under each of those categories? And what's really cool about this exercise is as you begin to go through this thought experiment, which is, you know, it's essentially a way for you to determine what you really want life to be like. But if you were to just simply ask that question to somebody, what do you want life to be like in 5 years? It's a very general sort of cookie cutter sort of question that can have cookie cutter answers, right? But this puts it into context. It allows you to really get specific with what in those areas of your life would make you say that life is awesome and exactly the way it should be. And this sheet, once you fill it out, becomes your guide for all the decisions that you make. And it's really important because now I use this sheet that I have for if I have a decision to make, I look at it and say, okay, does this align with where I want to be with my family or health-wise or et cetera? If not, then it makes it really easy for me to say no. And that's one of the hardest things to do as a human who especially one who is very people friendly and wants to say yes to everything. Mm-hmm. One of the hardest things to do is say no. But the truth is when you say yes to something, you're actually saying no to something else. So this exercise allows you to make sure you say yes to the right things and no to the right things based on where you actually want to be versus just what most people do is they just kind of live day by day without thinking that far ahead, and they're making decisions that who knows the ramifications of certain decisions that you're making now 5 years from now. But if you actually plan ahead and think about that future, then you can make the right decision now for that.
So then how important is having an extremely clear mission?
Well, think about this. If you are flying a plane, we'll use the plane analogy for Will It Fly.
Yep.
If you don't know where you're going, it can be kind of cool at the beginning, right? Because you're in the up in the air and you're flying around and there's nothing, sort of no restraints. You can go higher, lower, left, right, whatever. But eventually your gas is going to run out and you're going to have to land somewhere. Now, hopefully you have the wherewithal to land smoothly. But guess what? If you don't know where you're going, you might land in a place way further away from where you want to go. And so that often happens in life. We end up at the top of a ladder, for example, but just not the right ladder, or further away from our destination than we originally wanted, because we were just kind of living in that moment in a day-to-day thing without actually planning ahead. You know, you need to put that address in that navigator for it to tell you go left, go right. And yeah, sometimes you might take a wrong turn, but then it'll reroute you to go back to mission critical and where you want to go.
Awesome. What's the importance of the question, what makes you so special?
So in this world where we're all trying to build stuff and we're all trying to create things, your special abilities or your superpower, as I like to often say, is what's going to help you stand out and build something that is uniquely yours. A lot of times when people are trying to build businesses, it's like, oh, I want to do what that person's doing because it's already proven and it's already working. But you must put your own superpower into whatever work that you do, whether you become an entrepreneur or whether you're an employee. Putting your superpower, first of all, acknowledging and knowing that you have a superpower and you know what it is, you are then able to combine that with the work that you do to create something amazing and create amazing life experiences to truly provide value and serve others. If you don't know what that is, then you're kind of just doing work blindly almost. And it's only until, like, very successful entrepreneurs know what they're good at, and they make sure that that's what they do. And they also know what they're terrible at, and they often have somebody else do those things for them, right? So unless you know what you are good at and what makes you special, well, then you're kind of just messing around. So one of my favorite exercises and to offer sort of my students is to have them begin the hunt to find out what it is that their superpower is. And it's really hard to ask a person that question and have them tell you the answer. The trick is to have other people tell you the answer, because they are the ones who have this perception of who you are and why you're special. If you're a teacher, this is actually a really great exercise to run with your students, because then they were able to tell you what about you they like and the way that you teach. You could go even further and ask, okay, not only tell me what you feel like you think is my superpower, but what do you think is my kryptonite? What's the opposite? And that can get a little scary to hear, and you're opening the invite for, well, I don't like when you do this, or I don't like when you do that. And that can be scary, and you don't have to go down that route. Understanding the superpower is really important, but imagine if you could get honest advice, non-confrontational sort of thoughts on what you could do to improve, how valuable that would be for you and the communication that you have with people or whatever it is that your goal is and trying to do.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you for sharing on that. Speaking of teaching, you have on a really cool t-shirt. I'm wondering if you can share your meaning behind it. It says teach love.
Yeah, well, it actually says teach what you love, but people often read it from afar as teach love as well. And really the reason behind this, I mean, it's a shirt that comes from a company that I advise called Teachable, and it's an online platform that you can use to build online courses, really just drop in the videos, drop in the coursework. It's already set up for you, collects payments and all that stuff already. Anyway, teaching what you love helps other people love what you teach. Let me say that again. Teaching what you love also helps other people love what you teach. And so when you do that, your vibe is going to attract your tribe. I use a lot of rhyming things in my teaching. But anyway, what's really cool is that, you know, if you love something and you teach it, other people are going to start to empathize with you. They're going to really start to take these lessons that you're teaching them in life seriously. And it doesn't have to be in an online course setting. It doesn't have to be anything that's paid either. But with whoever you are teaching, your kids, your family, other friends, your employees, your boss, whatever, if you teach them stuff that you really are passionate about, they're going to feel a passion and know that you're coming from a place of honesty and not just doing it for the money, right? I mean, that's really what the context is here, is that, hey, you're not just teaching something to make money. You're teaching something that you love, and you get back that love from your students if that's the case.
Beautiful. And going along the rhyming lines, what about an attitude of gratitude?
an attitude of gratitude. You know, being grateful is one of the most important things that I've learned over the past couple of years. I use a journal every single day called the 5-Minute Journal, which allows you to check in with yourself daily to determine, you know, what are the great things in life that are happening right now? And it literally prompts you. It's not just a blank journal, but the journal, when you wake up in the morning and you start writing, it literally says, what are 3 things that you're grateful for today? And you just start writing those things down. And it's really cool to have just a minute in the morning to reflect on why life is amazing and what you have to be thankful for. Because guess what? Life isn't always going to go the way you want it to. But if you can check in with yourself daily as a practice, as a habit, you're going to begin to understand that, hey, life is good. Even if things don't go well all the time, I have these things that I can be thankful for and grateful for. I've been practicing that with our kids too. My wife and I, we often ask our children, both children, you know, at the dinner table, what's one thing that you're grateful for today? And it's a really great exercise. It gets them to think. And yes, sometimes it's, oh, I'm grateful for Mario, or I'm grateful for, you know, this TV show. And that's okay. It's something that makes them feel good. And then we kind of dive deeper into that sometimes. But a lot of times they say amazing things that you wouldn't expect. Like, I'm grateful for when grandpa holds my hand.
Cool.
Like, you wouldn't expect them to say that, but it just shows you how important those kinds of little moments are. And it just reaffirms that, you know, let's spend more time together as a family, that kind of thing.
Awesome. And on that line, my wife, Jessica, she's the producer. She always likes me to ask a question on parents for kids. What words of wisdom would you give parents today for their kids?
Well, first of all, lead by example. So it's one thing to tell your child to do something, right? But it's another thing to show them. And I think it's important to show them those failures sometimes. You know, I think traditionally parents would often want to just show their best face forward. And, you know, if the things were not going well, they wouldn't share any of that with their kids. But I think if you want an open, honest relationship with your kid, guess what? You have to be open and honest with them as well. And we are sort of laying the foundation right now with our kids at a young age to be open and honest with each other. So that's the first thing. And then also, hey, kids are crazy and they're going to drive you nuts, and it's okay to be frustrated. I think that's the other thing. It's like, a lot of times we feel like failures when our kids are just running amok or saying things maybe they shouldn't be saying, but you know, they pick up stuff from everywhere, and it's just, you got to be there to support them and just realize that they're still kids. I think I forget often how young my kids are. And sometimes I perhaps expect a little bit more from them, but then I have to kind of come back down to earth and realize, hey, we're all learning about this together. Let's just take a deep breath, like you said in the beginning of the show before we started, and calm down and just actually take wise steps from this point forward.
Beautiful. On that note, a couple quick wrap-up questions we have. First off, what personally brings you the greatest happiness, or what I call the woohoo factor?
So there's a lot of things. You know, I experience that every morning when I write in my gratitude journal. But I think, you know, my kids showing me that they're learning some of the things that I'm teaching. And, you know, they're also teaching me things too that I didn't realize about myself. So that's really important. But also, one of my favorite things is to get a thank you note from my audience. I don't know if you could see this. For those of you listening, you might not, you obviously can't see this, but behind me at my desk is this board that has hundreds of thank you notes on it, handwritten thank you notes from my audience. Whenever I get one of those in the mail, and it's every time I go at this point, which is amazing, it just makes me so happy. That's a woohoo moment for sure, because this shows me that I'm doing it right, right? Like, nobody would just randomly sits down and writes a handwritten thank you note to somebody. They do that when something is very meaningful to them. And so this is my barometer to determine whether or not I'm actually doing things correctly. It's not the income. It's not the followers or the likes or the shares. It's, am I getting a certain percentage of people to sit down and write to me and thank me for what I'm doing? Because if they do that, I know I'm doing something right.
And that is a woohoo! So where can people go to find out more and to find your fantastic books, to listen to your show and more?
Thank you so much. Well, you can find everything at smarttopassiveincome.com. If you want to check out that book specifically, which is very much specifically for the person who is just starting. If you have a business already and you know that that's the business you want to do, it's actually not for you. But for those of you who are just starting out, it would be perfect. Willitflybook.com.
Fantastic. And if you didn't catch that for whatever reason, come on over to inspirenationshow.com and we'll get you over to Pat as well. Pat, I want to thank you so much. Any last words of wisdom you want to share with people today?
Yeah, fail fast. You know, if you're building something, the quicker you can get to failure, the quicker you can learn from your mistakes and get to the point of success. That's something I've been learning myself, and teaching my kids too, because failure is an option. It's a part of the process of life, of building business. But the trick is to learn from those mistakes so that the next time around, you can have a better chance of succeeding. And sometimes it might take 100 fails, but it just takes that one to really make that big change that you're hoping for in your life.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And I've got to thank you for your sharing. I don't know if balance is even the right word. Priorities. You have your priorities. Everybody can have different priorities, but your priorities are so spot on, honest, genuine, and important today that I can't thank you enough for sharing that.
I appreciate you for that, for saying that. It is a conscious effort to make sure that the things in my life that are important are still at the top.
Awesome. So for everyone out there, this is Michael Sandler saying, be well, have fun, get will it fly, and grow those wings, and shine bright. Woohoo! Thank you so much, Pat.
Cool. That was a lot of fun, Michael. Thank you so much for the energy today.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!